Hi, I'm Rachel, and I figured I might as well throw my portfolio onto here since I watched a lot of accepted portfolio videos while I was putting together my own portfolio, which helped a lot, so I just wanted to return the favor, I guess. So I applied to two schools, both for early admission, SAIC and RISD. And I only applied to those two since RISD was binding anyways, and I figured if I didn't get in, I'd just apply to more schools after. But I got accepted into both of them, which is amazing because application fees are expensive. Anyways, I'll just talk through all the pieces in my portfolio, then I'll try to give some tips if my brain cell will cooperate. And then I'll go through stats and extracurriculars and stuff like that. Quick disclaimer, since I am not an actual admissions officer or anything, please take what I say with a grain of salt. What works for me might not work for you, and that's fine. Just try to find things that I do well or don't do well in and carry that forward into your own portfolio. I'm still learning, which is kind of why I'm going to school, you know, but yeah, any advice I give is from the perspective of someone who recently went through the whole uni application process. All right, let's jump right in. So the first piece in my portfolio is an acrylic painting. And I kind of drew from a lot of the objects that you would see at a construction site because I was just thinking of that like weird purgatory state where you're trying to grow and be a better person, but that process kind of sucks because you're in this place where you know you suck and it's hard, but like you gotta go through this ugly phase before you can actually grow and be a better person, you know? It's like how a construction site looks super ugly and messy, but in the end there's like, I don't know, like a new pretty building or something. So that's kind of the vibe that I was trying to do for this piece. I also added fish. I don't know why. It's mostly because there wasn't a lot of life and movement in the piece, so the fish kind of added that. But then it ended up looking more like an environmental piece instead of a piece that was supposed to reflect like a mental state. But it's fine, we're chilling. Yeah, I'm still pretty proud of how the fish and the rocks came out, so yeah. Next is this piece. I may or may not have been going through a rough time when I drew this, so you bet it's event art. Basically, the whole vibe is this kid is laying in a forest that recently went through a forest fire. The trees are black and scorched, but already there are signs of healing, like wildflowers growing behind him and the grass beneath him, and the foxes are returning. So yeah, the forest is kind of a reflection of the mental state of having just been through something hella rough. But, you know, whether you're a human or a forest, we're all like weirdly resilient, so yeah, you'll heal. Anyways, this piece is a watercolor and honestly really fun and therapeutic to draw. And just like most of my other watercolor stuff, it is inked, so all the shaded parts, there's a lot of hatching, so I don't have to spend a lot of time layering colors to get the right contrast and value, especially since value is always kind of risky with watercolor. So yeah, inking made life really easy for me, 10 out of 10 recommend, and it also helped me get all that extra texture with the fur on the fox and stuff like that. So yeah. This piece is another example of a watercolor piece. I don't really feel like explaining this one because I don't like it, so too bad. It was supposed to illustrate all the things that we stress about nowadays, but I don't know, I don't really like the composition. I don't think it's very effective, but I still included it just to vary up the mediums in my portfolio and to show that I can execute my ideas in many different mediums. Okay, this one was pretty fun, not gonna lie. Basically, my art teacher just showed me a bunch of abstract and surreal artists. The names are in Chinese though, so I don't really remember them. I don't think I can find them, but yeah, they were really cool and he showed me all these images and he was like, I want you to draw something in this style, just go wild. So this is kind of the result. It was really fun trying all the weird blending styles in watercolor and also played with some like colored ink and bits of it too. But yeah, don't ask me what it means because I don't know. I don't know what's going on. This next one is also an acrylic painting. It's basically just talking about how it's kind of useless to spend your life wishing you could turn back time to fix mistakes because it's not like you'll ever be able to move time and it'll keep moving forward anyways with or without you, and then you'll find yourself at the end of your life realizing you were trying so hard to go back to the past, you forgot to live in the present. So yeah, all of these pieces are so cheesy, I'm so sorry, but you gotta do what you gotta do, please bear with me, I guess. This was the second acrylic painting that I actually tried hard in, and yeah, I don't really like acrylics, I don't get how to blend it, it's not my favorite, but yeah, in this piece I got to play with a more illustrative style, and it was fun to like line the main figures in blue to get them to pop out and everything. And I got to play with more of a cell shading style compared to the blended shading that I usually lean towards. But yeah, I definitely need to get better at acrylics. But yeah, still did it in acrylics, again, just to vary up the mediums that I use in my portfolio. So this one, the meaning behind it is basically this guy is trying to get himself into this paradise that's just outside his apartment, right? Except he's trying to row a freaking bathtub, which is not exactly a method of transportation. And all the paper boats are his dreams and ambitions trying to reach that paradise, but oops, there are lizards about to attack and crumple them up. And also the apartment is also crumbling away, and this guy is still stubbornly rowing his bathtub to nowhere. So yeah, that's kind of the whole meaning behind it. This other pencil drawing has a similar meaning, where basically there's a conflict between the goal and how they are trying to reach that goal. And then this one is a camel chilling in a city. Yeah, that's it. All these pieces are all just pencil, so it was basically just to show my skill in depicting all these objects and people in pencil, like look at all the detail in the bathtub one, or like how I rendered the people in the car one, or like the texture of the fur in the camel one. So I was mostly just flexing my pencil abilities, I guess. Yeah. I also submitted these two pieces that I used for a National Remembrance Day contest that the Canadian Legion holds every year, and it was just kind of to show a little bit of improvement since it's on the same subject but drawn, I think, 2 years apart. So yeah, I just wanted to show my improvement and also show that, you know, I'm capable of improving and please accept me into your school. So yeah, I'm pretty proud of the pencil work in these pieces too. So these next ones are a few oil paintings, which, fun fact, is my favorite medium. So this one was my earliest oil painting that I did for my portfolio. It's not like my first oil painting ever. I started learning oil painting when I was, I think, in grade 9. So yeah, I have some experience in oil painting, and I'm pretty happy with how I rendered the faces and like the hands and stuff, but otherwise, like, I'm not really satisfied with how I did the composition. Like, it's just not as cool as I expected it to be, I guess, or I don't know, I think it's just too straightforward. But yeah, it could be just a change in taste, I guess. I think I painted this a year or two ago, so yeah. This robot painting was really just me trying to include the dike in our city into one of the pieces because I thought it's a really cool environment and I wanted to paint it. So I basically just took a picture that I took of the dike and added some objects and other things into the environment to make it a piece about the insignificance of human beings. So, too long didn't read version, one day humans will go extinct, and the things we create will crumble and fade, but the earth will still go on for a few billion years before the sun swallows it. So yeah, love that for us. Anyways, the clouds were super fun in this piece, and not gonna lie, I'm pretty proud of how the robot turned out because I usually suck at drawing metallic stuff, but hey, it looks pretty shiny, right? Haha. Anyways. Next one. This one was really challenging to draw. Like, all those light and wave stuff, that was rough. I had like 3 different reference images just trying to figure out how the head was gonna look, but I think it looks pretty cool in the end. So yeah. As for the meaning of this piece, it's basically a juxtaposition of how she looks at home. She's all cozied up in the ocean where, you know, technically she shouldn't be feeling at home, and the lighthouse is behind her, unable to guide her. And yeah, it's basically just posing the question of where does she actually belong. Okay, this next piece, I feel like this is a pretty typical, whoa, I grew up Asian Canadian or Asian American or whatever kind of take, but yeah, if you notice, she's wearing one Western shoe and one Chinese shoe, which also is kind of a play on the walk in someone else's shoes thing. Also, she is in a Chinese styled courtyard, but the furniture and everything is more European style. And then on top of that, all her clothes and stuff, I stuck pictures of what I thought was very stereotypical Western culture, which, by the way, was actually really hard to think of. I was just, is it fast food brands like sports? Capitalism? Anyways, the rest of the drawing is just watercolor and my Micron pens again. And yeah, this one was pretty simple. And I feel like this topic is done a lot by our demographic, but at the same time, like, this question of culture, at least in my opinion, is still really important to one's identity. And considering that, I decided to just go with it since I figured universities liked works that address identity and things like that. This next one, it's a pretty depressing one, oops. It's an oil painting, and basically I was just feeling pretty nihilistic and thinking about how, you know, eventually down the road, humans will be extinct and the sun will swallow up the earth and everything that everyone has worked hard for will be meaningless because there will be no one left to give it meaning. And how in the end, time will eat up everything. Which is kind of why the hourglass is leaking onto the canvas and like flooding up the whole setting. And yeah, all the faces on the highway-like structures basically represent how people are always trying to go somewhere and trying to do something, even though they might not know where they're trying to go or like what they're trying to do and why they're trying so hard in the first place. And yeah, basically saying how pointless everything feels sometimes. But yeah, we're vibing. Okay, this next piece is a collage that is centered around these three buttons that would be very familiar if you do digital art. So the undo button, the eraser tool, and the brush tool. And I guess I just thought of them as three different ways to respond to a disaster or a mistake. Like, do you try to undo something, or do you try to get rid of it entirely, or do you try to make something new out of it? And the scenery is very messy and chaotic, which is basically a depiction of the mistake. And the road the person is walking on is broken. The city she is heading towards is on fire, so it's basically putting her in the situation of how will she fix the mistake? Which button will she choose? And yeah, that's kind of the vibe I was going for. So this one is composed of a bunch of magazine clippings, watercolor, inks, and the girl was done in color pencils, and I kind of just cut her out and stuck her on there. Collages are pretty fun, and also, I definitely prefer using double-sided tape over glue. 10 out of 10. So my next piece is this one. So this is the last piece on my portfolio. I decided to end my portfolio off on a more hopeful note. So the whole idea in this piece is the person is kind of trapped and anchored by the city, which kind of represents like a lot of the daily turmoils and stresses that we gotta go through just to exist in this society. First world problems, we live in a society, lol. And then this other person, whether it's an extension of herself or like her dreams and things like that, that's up to interpretation. But basically she is pointing up and reminding herself that, you know, there is much more to life than just her daily toils, and you know, there's hope, and take a look at the bigger picture, because there are robins coming down to take apart those chains, and the clouds are pulling apart to reveal some sun, you know? So yeah, it's also pretty cheesy, but whatever. This piece is a watercolor, and I'm also really happy with how the birds turned out. I really like how I managed to capture the texture of their feathers and stuff, so yeah. And I'm also pretty proud of the clouds too. But yeah. So that was like my main portfolio bit, and then next is the RISD assignment. So there are two pieces that are in a separate section from your main portfolio in Slide Room. So like the pieces in the RISD assignment are not included in the 12 to 20 limit of your main portfolio, and the prompt also changes every year in, I believe, August, I think. So yeah, make sure to check that you're doing the right prompt, because I made the mistake of creating pieces to the wrong prompt, which was kind of annoying, but it's fine because I threw them in my portfolio anyways. But yeah, just double check that. So the prompt I had to do for my year was begin by observing a phenomenon or choosing an object in the natural world. Create a visual reaction to this object or phenomenon. You may use any medium and work at any scale. Document this work and upload it as your first response. I then had to make a transformation or modification on the first response to make the second part of the assignment. So yeah, you make two pieces. I'm not gonna lie, I kinda just drew whatever I wanted to draw and then adapted it to fit the assignment better. Since it's so vague anyways, I figured I could get away with it. So I always wanted to draw something from an East Asian myth, legend kinda idea, and I also wanted to make a print of some kind, so I killed two birds with one stone by making this piece. It's called The Legend of Jing Wei, and the story, for those of you who aren't familiar with it, it's about this goddess who goes into the ocean to play and ends up drowning, and she then transforms, or resurrects, it's not clear, into a bird and spends the rest of eternity finding sticks and stones in an attempt to fill up the ocean, either as revenge or so no one will suffer the same fate. Maybe both. That's also unclear. Either that or like my Chinese sucks. But basically, Jing Wei became a symbol of like stubbornly or bravely facing impossible odds. And I thought this kind of connected to the prompt in like how we are seeing an increase of extreme natural disasters as a result of climate change. And like all these hurricanes and floods that we see more and more of every year, it kind of feels like we're Jing Wei fighting something that is so much more bigger than us, you know? And yeah, This piece was so fun, but also so painstaking to do. I had to carve two huge boards, one for all the blue parts and one for all the black parts, and I don't know why I decided to include like hatching and the hands and stuff, because that was such a pain to carve, but I do kind of like how it turned out. It's very dramatic, which is kind of a good vibe. Anyways, for the transformation, so like the second part of the assignment, I decided to move from a natural phenomenon, like hurricanes and floods and whatever, to a man-made phenomenon. That is capitalism. I unofficially call it eat the rich, but anyways, you know, the composition and waves is pretty similar to the Jingwei one, which kind of clues into how it's a series, except this time the waves are cut up pieces of money, which, don't worry, is just like scanned copies of bills. I'm not that rich. The meaning is pretty literal. All this greed and pursuit of money and whatever will one day consume us, or well, it's kind of consuming us right now, and how it feels like all the politicians and big people in the world care more about the economy than human lives. Yeah, billionaires should not exist. Amazing. Okay. So yeah, that kind of concludes everything that I put in my portfolio. In total, including the RISD assignment pieces, there were 19 pieces, and I started working on my portfolio around grade 10, I believe, because I'm honestly not that fast, so yeah, I could have better time management for sure. But as for how I decided on the order of my portfolio, I basically wanted the first and last piece to be really strong, you know? So I chose what I thought were my strongest pieces, and I put them there. Then I kind of sorted the rest of my portfolio, keeping thematically similar pieces together, so there's kind of a flow to things, but also trying to vary up the types of mediums throughout the portfolio. So let's move on to tips. My number one tip is, if you can, go to a portfolio day. It's super helpful if you're not sure what your portfolio needs to improve, and you also get a better idea of what admissions people are looking for when they're judging your portfolios. And I also found it super helpful to understand the vibes of each school. So if you need help deciding on which school you want to go to, Portfolio Day is really helpful with that. Like, I didn't really think about SAIC that much until I went to visit them for Portfolio Day, and they were so helpful in their critique, which made me think that I'd be able to learn a lot from them, you know? Which is why I applied to them as well. So yeah, if you can, I really highly encourage you to go to Portfolio Day. Secondly, I'm just going to point out that I don't actually have any figure drawings in my portfolio. I did worry about whether it would negatively affect my portfolio, but also I don't really have any figure drawing classes in my city that I know of, or at least I didn't find any while I was making my portfolio. So anyways, if you're really desperate for a figure drawing, you can probably draw from online pictures, and there's a lot of those figure drawing websites which are really good even just for practice that can like time you with drawing poses and stuff like that, and I definitely should do them, but oops, I'm lazy. Anyways, the point is, I kind of made up for the lack of figure drawings, or at least in my opinion, I made up for it. I don't know if I actually did make up for it or not, but you know, since a lot of my pieces have people in them, and in all the pieces, the people are in all sorts of different poses and in the middle of like movement and motion and stuff like that. So I thought that it came across through those pieces that, yeah, I have a grasp on human figure and anatomy, and I can demonstrate forms and stuff, which I think is kind of the point of a figure drawing anyways, so yeah. Don't take this as like a, oh, I definitely don't need a figure drawing, because it's definitely an important skill. But also, you know, somehow I finessed my way into RISD without a figure drawing, so yeah, maybe it's not like a life or death thing. Another thing I want to bring up right now, because I think with a lot of portfolios, people will try to include like still lives and things like that. But when I went to Portfolio Day, a lot of the people that were reviewing my portfolio were like, oh my gosh, thank goodness there are no apple paintings, which basically meant that I didn't have any boring still lives of like a basket of fruit or an apple or things like that. Because the only thing a basket of fruit tells the portfolio reviewers is that you can draw what you see. And frankly, a lot of people can draw what they see. And it doesn't tell the admissions people how you think or how you approach art or how you feel, and it doesn't really tell them if you will be able to thrive in an art school where you have to create a lot of your own projects and things like that. And also, just the admissions people want to see the person behind the painting, and they want to see that you can create the ideas in your own head and not just copy what's in front of you. Besides, still lives are really just proof technical ability, which the admissions people can see based off your original pieces anyways. So like, if you look at my paintings, for example, like they can see based off that Rachel can render hands and faces or draw landscapes or like objects like a double bass without me needing to do like a still life, you know? And like, in these original original pieces, they can see how I approach art and like the angle at which I depict ideas. So yeah, I hope I'm making sense. But like, if you do intend to draw a still life, I don't think it will be something that will detract from a portfolio. Just make sure that it's more interesting, it has a story or like a personality or something, so that it can say something more about you. Also, side note, but I know for SAIC in particular, they like more personal pieces. For example, a lot of my pieces are kind of, I think I'm kind of deep or something, or like, it's kind of like my commentary on certain topics. But during portfolio day, the person said that he would have really preferred it if I focused my pieces on things that are personal to me, like my feelings and my life. And so he liked all of like those event arts or those more emotional type pieces a lot more. So yeah, I think making sure that all of your pieces in your portfolio reflect something about you personally is pretty important, just because that way the admissions people will be able to see what type of person you are and what type of student you would be through your portfolio. Another small tip is that there's a description box in Slide Room, and I basically treated it as a place to write an artist statement for each piece. So I wrote not only about the meaning, but also like what medium I used, why I used it, and so on. And yeah, I can't say how much weight they put on the description section, but I wrote a lot anyways, just in case. So yeah, I don't think it'll hurt to just go ham there. Right, that's all my brain can think of for tips right now, so let's talk about stats. Alright, so if you want to know my GPA and my SAT scores, they are here. Sorry, I don't really know what my weighted 4.0 skill is, but I'd assume it's above a 4. Anyways, I honestly didn't have that many extracurriculars, like I'm not a debate kid or a sports kid or anything, so I don't really have that much helping me spice up my personal profile. Honestly, if I wasn't applying to art school, I'd definitely be screwed, but yeah, let's not talk about that. Also, my school didn't have any type of AP art classes, so I didn't take any of those, which kind of sucks, but whatever. Frankly, art school's art program is super small, so none of the works in my portfolio are any school assignments. I did them all outside of school with my drawing teacher, who is hella legit and I'm so thankful for. But yeah, anyways, for the AP classes that I did take, I took AP Psych, AP Lang, and AP Art History, and I got 5s in all of them. And I'm also taking AP Lit right now, but with the whole COVID situation, I don't really know if I'm in the mood to take the exam, so yeah, we'll see. Anyways, as for competitions and stuff, I did some Scholastic Awards and got Silver Keys twice, which isn't like super remarkable, I guess, but you know, it's a good competition and definitely recommend you try it out. Also, in Canada, as I mentioned earlier, they have a National Remembrance Day contest where you draw like a poster. So I did manage to get first place in the province for that competition contest thing. Yeah. I don't know how much these awards like weigh into my acceptance, because I'm not really decked out in medals and whatever, and I also never did any like galleries or shows or things like that, but you know, I'm still in RISD, which is kind of all that matters, right, Lamal? So yeah. Anyways, I think that's about it for my rambling. I hope it was understandable and helpful. If you have any questions or want to know more details about my college application, feel free to ask in the comments. Or you can hit me up on my Instagram, shameless plug, follow me there for like more art and stuff, whatever. Anyways, if you're applying to any art schools and stuff, I wish you all good luck, and thanks for watching. Bye!